have had a remarkable history in this room. In 1939, Frank Sinatra began his career here. On our watch, your good man Charlie Brown launched the careers of Bob Balaban, Gary Berghoff, and one of our ushers, Billy Crystal. But we rarely go into this particular piece of the depth of our history, but in light of tonight's performance, we are also inordinately proud of the fact that this is where the free speech for the New York Theater began, when Lord Buckley had his cabaret card taken by the Vice Squad in October of 1960, and he was later then very likely beaten to death by the police. And it changed the nature of American theater. We have always been at the forefront of the free speech fight, and so we are greatly honored and pleased to have this particular performance here tonight. By the way, after the show, we have Breffin crepes and cider in the bar, so please do help keep small theaters alive. And now, with great pleasure, I welcome Suzanne Nossel, who is the director of the Pan American Center, to tell you more about the performance this evening.
Thanks so much, and welcome, everyone. Last month, I traveled to China to meet with writers, editors, and publishers who are working under the heavy pressures of Beijing's censorship and repression. One of the most startling takeaways from the trip was the extent to which, despite the internet, despite cell phones, despite social media, the Chinese are succeeding in controlling the flow of information to their population of 1.3 billion people. One of the starkest examples of that control is the enforced collective amnesia regarding critical events in Chinese history. We spoke to a 30-year-old Oxford PhD student who told us that none of his peers know that the Tiananmen Square massacre even happened. They can't read about it, they don't study it, and their parents have learned not to talk about it with them. The same is true of the Great Famine that occurred during the Cultural Revolution. 30 million people starved to death, but the Chinese history books don't discuss it. And the leading historical account, a book called Tombstone by the writer Yang Jicheng, cannot be published in China. When I got home from China, I told all this to my 10-year-old son, Leo. His question was, how do we know what secrets our government is keeping from us? Well, the Guantanamo Diary is the story of a secret our own government has been keeping from us. It's hidden in plain sight. We know about the detainees, we know about torture, and yet this book shocks us. We know, yet we don't know. When you work at Penn, you get asked about the connection between human rights and literature. We can read newspaper accounts, congressional testimony, human rights reports, and I'm for all that. Yet until we read a work of literature, something that moves us, that we can't put down, that we can't ignore. Until then, the government's secrets are still safe. On behalf of Penn American Center, we could not be prouder of Larry Seams, the editor of this book. Larry is the former director of Penn's Freedom to Write program, which he led for more than 17 years. Larry has done, in a powerful way, what has eluded all of us as advocates over so long. He has brought a Guantanamo detainee on shore to our living rooms, our nightstands, and our dinner tables. And he's done it in Mohamedou Slahi's own words. Penn has something called the Free Word Festival that we put on all over the world. Larry has freed the word. He's created an antidote to amnesia and shared secrets that can never be secret again. Thank you.
I have the privilege at the ACLU of being one of Mohamedou Slahi's lawyers. I wanted to start by thanking our co-hosts at Penn, the readers you'll be hearing from tonight, and all of you who are here to mark the release of Mohamedou's Guantanamo Diary. It should be Mohamedou standing here today, telling all of us his full story, uncensored by the government that tortured and continues to detain him unlawfully. Until that day happens, though, and we are fighting to make sure his release comes soon, we have the gift of his words. Senator John McCain, who knows about torture, having been subjected to it himself, said at a time when our nation was debating whether we should loosen the restrictions formally on torture, "It's not about them, it's about us." The notion being that us were the people who don't torture and shouldn't torture, and them were the people who challenge our decision not to torture. Mohamedou's book, I think, complicates that narrative, hopefully irrevocably. In a place devoted to dehumanizing them, Mohamedou and other prisoners like him, Mohamedou instead humanizes those who were asked to represent us, his American torturers and jailers, in an effort to understand why they did what they would do. At a time when torture was United States official policy, one of our nation's victims tried to understand not just why, but with what consequences. You'll hear tonight some of the impact of the torture on Mohamedou. And at a time when our debate about torture has been too much about its effectiveness, I hope you will be unsurprised to be reminded that there are only two things that torture guarantees: pain and false information. He tries to understand and describe what happens when a nation asks its soldiers to try and break the minds and bodies of their fellow human beings. He comes to think of his kinder guards as his family, at the same time that he remembers and longs for every day the family that he left behind, the family that is still waiting for him to come home. Part of the hope that I think this book brings is the fact that it has become a bestseller here and is becoming a bestseller in other parts of the world. I think that gives a lie to the view that Americans don't care about Guantanamo or about the people who are held there. That once we know his story, we will help to end the injustice that it reflects and the injustice that continues to hold Mohamedou and so many others still at Guantanamo.
I hated the sounds of the heavy metal chains. I can hardly carry them when they're given me. People were always getting taken from the block, and every time I heard the chains, I thought it would be me. You never know what's going to happen in the interrogation. People sometimes never came back to the block. They just disappeared. It happened to a Moroccan fellow detainee, and it happened to me, as you're going to learn, God willing. Later on, I learned from my great lawyers, redacted, that the magic formulation of my request is a petition for a writ of habeas corpus. Obviously, that phrase makes no sense to the average mortal man like me. The average person would just say, "Why the hell are you locking me up?" I'm not a lawyer, but common sense dictates that after 3 years of interrogating me and depriving me of my liberty, the government at least owes me an explanation of why it's doing so. What exactly is my crime?
Look, redacted is cooperating, and he has a good chance of getting his sentence reduced to 27 years. And redacted is a really bad person. Somebody like you needs only talk for 5 minutes, and you're a free man, said redacted. He was everything but reasonable. When I contemplated his statement, I was like, God, a guy who is cooperating is going to be locked up for 27 more years? After which he won't be able to enjoy any kind of life. What kind of harsh country is that?
July 2002 to February 2003. Bring me to the court, and I'll answer all your questions, I would tell the team. There will be no court, they would answer. Are you a mafia? You kidnap people, lock them up, and blackmail them, I said. You guys are a law enforcement problem, said redacted. We cannot apply the conventional law to you. We need only circumstantial evidence to try. I don't care what the reports say. I'd just like you to take a look at the report from January 2000 linking me to the Millennium Plot. And you now know that I'm not a part of it after the cooperation of Redacted. I don't think that you are a part of it, nor do I believe that you know Redacted. But I do know that you know people who know Redacted, said Redacted. I don't know, but I don't see the problem if it is the case, I replied. Knowing somebody is not a crime, no matter who he is.
Going grew worse with every day passing by. He started to lay out my case. He began with the story of and me having recruited him for the September 11th. All you have to say is, I don't remember, I don't know, I've done nothing. You think you're going to impress an American jury with these words? In the eyes of the Americans, you're doomed. Just looking at you in an orange suit, chains, being Muslim and Arabic is enough to convict you. But we know that you are a criminal. Done? Will you tell me? Otherwise, you'll never see the light of day. If you don't cooperate, well, we're going to put you in a hole and wipe your name out of our detainee database. I don't care where you take me. Just do it. When I failed to give him the answer he wanted to hear, he made me stand up with my back bent, because my hands were shackled to my feet and waist and locked to the floor. Turned the temperature control all the way down and made sure that the guards maintained me in that situation until he decided otherwise. I always wondered how Boing could possibly have passed the Army's fitness test. But I realized, he was in the Army for a reason. He was good at being inhumane.
The fact that I wasn't allowed to see the light made me enjoy the short trip between my freaking cold cell and the interrogation room. It was just a blessing when the warm Gitmo sun hit me. I felt life sneaking back into every inch of my body. I would always get this fake happiness, though only for a very short time. It's like taking narcotics. What was wrong with me? Just one soothing word in this ocean of agony was enough to make me cry. Redacted, we had a complete Puerto Rican division. They were different than other Americans. They were not as vigilant or unfriendly. Sometimes, they took detainees to shower, redacted. Everyone liked them, but they got in trouble with those responsible for the camps because of their friendly and humane approach to the detainees. I can't objectively speak about the people of Puerto Rico because I haven't met enough. However, if you ask me, have you ever seen a bad Puerto Rican guy? My answer would be no.
February 2003 to August 2003. And today we're going to teach you about great American sex. Get up, said Redacted. I stood up in the same painful position as I had every day for about 70 days. I would rather follow the orders and reduce the pain that would be caused when the gods came to play. The gods used every contact opportunity to beat the hell out of the detainee. The detainee tried to resist was the gospel truth. You're very smart, because if you don't stand up, it's going to be ugly, Redacted. As soon as I stood up, two Redacted took off their blouses and started to talk all kind of dirty stuff you can imagine, which I minded less. What hurt me most was them forcing me to take part in a sexual threesome in the most degrading manner. What many Redacted don't realize is that men get hurt the same as women if they're forced to have sex, maybe more due to the traditional position of the man. Both Redacted stuck on me, literally one on the front and the other older Redacted stuck on my back, rubbing Redacted's whole body on mine. At the same time, they were talking dirty to me and playing with my sexual parts. I am saving you here from quoting the disgusting and degrading talk I had to listen to from noon or before until 10 p.m. when they turned me over to Redacted, the new character you'll soon see. Of course, they didn't want me to die, but they understood there are many steps before one dies. You're not going to die. We're going to feed you up your ass, said Redacted.
February 2003 to August 2003. I have never felt as violated in myself as I had since the DOD team started to torture me to get me to admit things I haven't done. You, dear reader, could never understand the extent of the physical and much more the psychological pain people in my situation suffer. But the problem is that you cannot just admit to something you haven't done. You need to deliver the details, which, when you can't, when you hadn't done anything, it's not just, yes, I did. No, it doesn't work that way. You have to make up a complete story that makes sense to the dumbest dummies. One of the hardest things to do is tell an untruthful story and maintain it. And that is exactly where I was stuck. We're going to do this with you every single day, day in, day out, unless you speak about Redacted and admit your crimes, said Redacted. Humiliation, sexual harassment, fear, and starvation was the order of the day until around 10 p.m.
Redacted was aware that he was committing heavy war crimes, and so he was ordered by his bosses to cover himself. When I got to know Redacted more and heard him speaking, I wondered, how could a man as smart as he possibly accept such a degrading job, which surely is going to haunt him for the rest of his life? Maybe he had a few choices, because many people in the army come from poor families, and that's why the army sometimes gives them the dirtiest job. I mean, theoretically, Redacted could have refused to commit crimes of war, and he might even get away with it. Later on, I discussed with some of my guards why they executed the order to stop me from praying. Redacted started playing a track very loudly. I mean, very loudly. The song was, Let the Bodies Hit the Floor. I might never forget that song. At the same time, Redacted turned on some colored blinkers that hurt the eyes. If you fucking fall asleep, I'm gonna hurt you, he said. I had to listen to the song over and over until the next morning. I started praying. Stop the fucking praying, he said loudly. I think you deserve hell more than I do, because you're working dutifully to get there.
Fear, malignant evil, just because you can get around the rule technically doesn't mean it's morally right.
It is so contrary to Geneva Convention and what the American military is trained to do. I told the prosecution team that I wanted us to do this in a way that our grandkids could look back at Guantanamo the way that we look back at Nuremberg.
I truly believe a lot more interrogators would have spoken out against torture had it not been for the risk of losing their security clearance, which meant they would lose their job.
I decided to speak out about this issue. It was probably one of the most difficult decisions I made in my life, because I love the FBI. I love what I used to do.
I filed a report with the Department of Defense, a law of armed conflict violation report.
It was my obligation to try to learn more about it and put it to a stop.
I felt isolated in my fight to report the people who were conducting the torture interviews.
It wasn't a program that came from the bottom up. That was a program that came from the top down. And when they had people who didn't want to be part of the program, these people were marginalized.
At that point, I didn't know, you know, were they going to court-martial me? And in fact, I was placed under house arrest.
I said, look, we're not going to use, you know, any evidence that was obtained by torture or any of the other enhanced techniques that any of you feel went too far.
What I wanted to focus on was to tell people they've been presented this false choice.
It's not worth losing yourself for this.
Part of being a leader is standing up and trying to lead for your team, so I'd like to think that's what I tried to do.
So let's talk enemy to enemy, Redacted said. He opened my cell and offered me a chair. Redacted did the talking for the most part. He was talking about how great the U.S. is and how powerful. America is this, American is that. We Americans are so-and-so. During our conversations, he sneakily tried to make me admit to things I really hadn't done. What was your role in September 11th? I didn't participate in September 11th. Bullshit! He screamed madly.
To my surprise, Redacted came the next day and briefed the guards that the water bottle now belonged in my cell. You cannot imagine how happy I was to be able to decide the time and the amount of water I could drink. People who have never had, have never been in such a situation cannot really appreciate the freedom of drinking water whenever they want, however much they want.
Keep your faith. I'm sure it will guide you in the right direction. I used to debate faith with one of the new guards. Redacted was raised as a conservative Catholic. He was not really religious, but I could tell he was his family's boy. I kept trying to convince him that the existence of God is a logical necessity. I don't believe in anything unless I can see it, he told me. Personally, I do have faith, and I picture him and these other guards as good friends if we could meet under different circumstances. May God guide them and help them make the right choices in life.
I want to let you know that this is part of an ongoing conversation that we're having. Penn is really committed to engaging with these kinds of topics. We have an event on the 19th at FIAF, kind of exploring political satire in the wake of the Charlie Hebdo massacre. And we're also doing other kinds of events. We have Amanda Palmer at the Ace Hotel on March 2nd. So we really hope that you'll join our community. And thank you very much for coming out. Thank you.